As I'm sure you can tell, we're doing things a little bit different here in the new year, so y'all bear with us as we get this figured out. Hey, Mike, it's so good to have y'all up here. It's so good to see you guys. All right, if we haven't met, my name is Julian. I'm the lead pastor for this service. It's my delight to be here with you in worship. Let me invite you right off the bat to turn with me in your Bibles to Exodus chapter 20. Exodus chapter 20 is where we're going to hang out for the evening. Now, while you're in the process of turning, let me say a couple things to you. Firstly, thank you for being here. It's the first weekend of the new year, and that you have chosen to spend that time here with us is a delight, a pure delight. I'm so glad that you are here and not doing other things. I know that the Houston Texans are playing. Y'all probably don't care about that. I do. But I'm glad that you all are here with us. Secondly, if you don't have a Bible and you'd like one, we'd love to be responsible for getting one to you. So you can send me an email to pastorjulian@fmcm.org, and our team would love to get one to you. Now, if you don't want to wait for that, you can go right outside these double doors after the service, and our team at the Connecting Point can get a Bible into your hands tonight. So, I'm sure you've heard it plenty over the last 6 days, but you haven't heard it from me, so let me officially say it to you. Happy New Year. All right, cool. Yeah, that's fine. Y'all don't have to say it back. It's fine. Happy New Year. Happy New You. All the things that they say at the beginning of the new year. My wife and I were talking the other day. She'd been doing a devotional, and what had come to her mind was more in 24. I said, I like that, boo. I'm going to make sure that makes it into the sermon. So I want more in 24, more joy, more peace, more love, more kindness, more in 24 for you. And I love this time of year. I love the new year because this is such an incredible time of year that drives us, that pulls us into this time of reflecting and resetting. It's a time for pivots. During this time, many of us make resolutions, we join gyms, we start new diets, we do all of these highly aspirational things because this is a time where we are the most intentional about looking at and evaluating our habits. The habits. Life is lived in the habits. It's in the day-to-day, the regular practices that produce our life's rhythm. And during this time, we look and see, are my habits generating the kind of life that I want to live? And that's the question that we find ourselves coming to at the beginning of a new year. I see that I need to pivot, but how will I do it? What habits will I introduce into my life to take me to the place that I ultimately desire? It's the habits. Turn to your neighbor and say, it's the habits. There we go. In 24, I'm making y'all participate more in 24. Here we go. Because we've been on break, Jocelyn and I have had more time to be able to spend together and share mornings together. And we were the other day discussing the book Atomic Habits, which I highly recommend that you check out. And the author of the book argues this point. You do not rise to the level of your goals. You fall to the level of your systems. I'm going to say that part again, and I'm going to get to the rest because I think that's good. You don't rise to the level of your goals. You fall to the level of your systems. Your goal is the desired outcome. Your system is the collection of daily habits that will get you there. I think that's good. It's a strong statement because it's not our desires, it's your decisions that determine the trajectory of your life. It's the habits. It's the habits. And I think I learned this lesson maybe most when I was playing for different people. As a musician, this gave me the greatest lesson on the power of habits. Now, I'm largely self-taught on the piano. I'm largely a self-taught piano player. I took piano lessons for a little while as an elementary student, and then I was in band from sixth grade to my first year of college. And so I have this kind of dual experience of this very informal picking up from other musicians learning how to play and then sitting in a band class with the band director playing with a sheet of music. One of the things that was similar about either experience, really the only piece of advice that they both gave when I was bothering them as a young student trying to figure out how to learn how to play, was one piece of simple advice. It was just this: practice your scales. Now, when you see somebody that's ripping off your Elise or playing Earth, Wind, and Fire, the last thing you want to do is to go play some scales. And if you don't know what scales are, trust me, you've heard them all throughout your life in any piece of song. In fact, if you've seen Mary Poppins and remember the Do-Re-Mi song, that whole song is just a scale. That's what that is. So they were telling me to go practice that. And they did this, they gave me this piece of advice because all music is simply based upon scales. If I were to say that differently, scales are the fundamental source for all music. In other words, if you understand and build a dexterity with scales, you can learn how to play just about anything. Now, that served me well as a musician because the way that I grew up playing the piano was mainly in a Black Baptist church. Now, what that means, for those of you that don't know, for the under-affiliated and uninitiated, there were times where we would have to play in a service and a guest preacher would come and they would just start singing something and then you had to play it. I'm like, who knows this song? This dude made this up on the way to church. There's no way. This is a real song. But if you know the scales, if you can find your way through the environment that is unfamiliar to you. I can see that some of you all don't see where I'm going, so let me make it plain for you. In your life, you may find yourself coming up against a problem, a season, a time that may be beyond you, and sometimes you've got to improvise. The environment is too unfamiliar, and you've got to create music where there are no notes on the page. Your capacity to make music out of the discord in your life is situated in the habits that you have instituted in your life. In other words, if you haven't spent time in the practice room, you won't fare well in the performance. Can I get an amen on that? It's the habits. The habits. It's the habits that we practice in private that determine how well we will perform on the stage of life. It's the decisions, not the desires, that determine our trajectory in life. And if you want to live a good life, you've got to practice good habits. Now, I'm convinced, I think each of us, whether you can articulate it or not, has a vision of what you see for your life, for the lives that we want. Regardless of the means, I think we all want a life marked by peace. We want to love and be loved. We want joy. But the question is, how will I get there? How do I make the pivots? How do I make the shifts? What will I do today in the days to come to get me to the life that I am longing for? If it's true that I don't rise to the level of my goals, but I fall to the level of my habits, what habits produce a good life? Now, if you're hearing me, and I mean if you're really hearing me, if this is resonating with you at all, let me tell you, brother, let me tell you, sister, you are not alone. We're all asking that question of ourselves, and I think Scripture provides an answer regarding the habits that produce a good life. So today, on this first Saturday of the new year, we are going to pivot. Over the next several years as a church community, we'll begin the year by immersing ourselves in a specific spiritual practice. Here's a listing of what we will cover over the next several years. Y'all see that list? If you can take a picture, but trust me, you're going to get plenty of this over the next several years. This year, however, our focus is going to be on the ancient practice of Sabbath. We're going to engage in the Sabbath practice, and we're committed to helping each other experience the grace of God in Sabbath throughout the year, but these first 4 weeks of the year will be dedicated to learning and finding ways to incorporate it in our lives. So now, you should have had plenty of time. That was me stalling real good. If you're in Exodus 20, if you've got it marked, if you're there, say amen. If you're not, you ought to be ashamed of yourself. Exodus 20, beginning at verse 8, through verse 11, the text reads like this. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, neither you nor your son or daughter, nor your male or female servant, nor your animals, nor any foreigner residing in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea, and all that is in them, but he rested on the seventh day. Therefore, the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. There's a lot, frankly, to unpack in all of those verses. And as much as I would love to, I won't have the time to do all of that tonight. Fortunately, we got a couple weeks for me to be able to do this. And we will over the next several weeks. But tonight, I want to help us begin to make the pivot. If you've ever played any sport that required you to pivot, you know that a pivot requires you to bring all of your momentum in one direction to a complete stop in order to quickly go in another direction. So before we get into the ins and outs of Sabbath over the next couple of weeks, I just want to talk to you this week about stopping. Stopping. Now, before we jump in, he's not going to be happy about this because I didn't warn him. T, can you come up here real quick? Thank you, brother. Appreciate it. I thought about asking him, and then I didn't want him to tell me no, so I just didn't ask, and then I'm asking for forgiveness right now in front of everybody. Everybody's watching us, brother, so please don't. Thank you. All right, so just come up here. I'm gonna need you in a second. All right. If you know me well, then you know that I love music. It's been a huge part of my life for most of my life. And in preparing for this message, I even wanted to find some different things that different people have, ways that they have described what music is. So I want to share a few with you. Tolstoy said this, music is the shorthand of emotion. I think that's nice. Hans Christian Andersen said, where words fail, music speaks. I really like that one. I even heard recently somebody that I think of as wise say this, that music is the science of vibration, harmony, melody, and rhythm. And it's that last one, rhythm, that I think is important. So let me ask you this. Have you ever experienced someone who just had no rhythm? Some of y'all are like not turning your heads at all, so you might be sitting next to that person, so just look at me, blink yet once for yes, twice for no. But if you've been line dancing and then somebody that just don't know the steps, don't got the beat, then they bumping into everybody, it's just not fun. It ain't fun for anybody around them. Everybody's watching their toes. Or better yet, here's the one that drives me nuts. And it's an involuntary response for this. I hate when people clap off beat. Like I buckle when it happens, and I've had to leave spaces because I don't want to offend nobody. And sometimes I usually just end up starting to clap louder than everybody so I can get the whole room on the right beat. Here's if you don't know what I mean, and I remember in high school, I think we had this in Mr. Clark's room, in the choir director, there was a sign that said, friends don't let friends clap on 1 and 3. I thought that was words to live by. You just shouldn't do it. Y'all know what I mean by clapping on 1 and 3? Some of y'all don't. Okay, here we go. Let me explain. Here's what I mean. All right. T, I just need you to play a couple bars of a pattern in 4. See, I can say it like that because he know. You know what I'm saying? We musicians. He knows. Go ahead. All right. Now, while he's playing, where do you think y'all supposed to clap? All right, some of y'all got confused. Yeah. Some of y'all were just on 1 and 3. All right. Good. Cool. Yeah. Y'all got it. Now, some of y'all started off on 1, 3, and I almost left the pulpit because I can't do it. Okay? That's it. That's all I needed. Thank you, brother. I just wanted to thank you. I just wanted to prove this point. One, we got 51 more weeks of this, so I need to make sure that this room is clapping on beat because I can't stand it. Now, Now, this was just a song. This was like, there's no danger here. And every now and again, I find myself in spaces where people clap on the wrong beat, and then I cringe, and then I leave the room and do all the stuff. But there's nothing dangerous about it. There's no moral or ethical or personal dilemma or danger for going against the rhythm of what just happened here in the room. There is, however, a rhythm in creation. Our text points to this by highlighting what took place at the beginning of all created reality. I'm sure that you remember the story of creation. It's in Genesis 1 and 2 and all of that. But the text tonight highlights what happens on the last day. And it says in verse 11, the text that we read tonight, "For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea, and all that is in them. But he rested on the seventh day." That is a pattern. That's a rhythm. That's an order that is instituted by God at the very beginning of everything. And isn't it interesting? The text goes on to say that he blessed that day and made it holy. Now, I don't know about you. I can only speak for me, and that's for me and my house. But if the Lord is blessing something, that's where I want to be. I don't want to run against it. I don't want to receive. I want to be in the place where I can receive what he has for me in the blessed place. And he blessed the Sabbath day. Now, there's all this momentum and motion going on for 6 days. God makes all of creation, but he gets to the seventh day and he stops. He rests. He pivots from activity to rest, and he blesses it. Now, surely this isn't because he grows tired. It's not because God got sleepy on the job. Psalm 121, the psalmist tells us anyway, "My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep." So he stands at the ready. God isn't a watchman that gets tired on the job and needs to take a few winks. That's not it. Why does he rest then? Why does he stop? Let me suggest to you that in the same way in Matthew's gospel that Jesus teaches us how to pray, God teaches us about the rhythm embedded in creation. He models for us that there is a natural balance between work and rest, and that is inherent to the rhythm of this life. Now, here's what's interesting. Do you know that the whole world functions on a 7-day cycle? Sunday to Saturday, the whole world operates this way, and it isn't based on any other natural phenomena. And there are things that are. A day is 24 hours because that's how long it takes for the earth to rotate. A month is based on the moon's lunar cycle. A year is based on the number of days it takes for the earth to revolve around the sun. The 7-day cycle of a week is simply based on this pattern of creation. In our study, pastors and I have there's a whole lot of material. But one of the things that we were looking at, the author had this to say. This was a fun fact that I had no idea about. The last time a serious attempt to change the 7-day week was made was in 1793 during the French Revolution. They did this to attempt to increase productivity. Here were the results. Productivity plummeted. And not only that, much worse, there was a rash of suicides and a spread of mental illness. In other words, there's a pattern, a rhythm set in our hearts and in our bodies that calls us to work and rest. And you can go against the rhythm, but it's a little bit like clapping off beat or dancing the wrong steps around everyone else. It throws you off. It throws off everybody who is connected to you. And there's a disharmony that we experience when we run against the rhythm embedded in creation. In fact, the philosopher H.H. Farmer said it this way: when you go against the grain of the universe, you get splinters. I like that. Anybody got splinters in their life? Places of fracture and brokenness. Perhaps You don't need to fix it. Perhaps what you just need to do is stop. Creation has a rhythm, and the beat ain't changing just because you don't like the song. That'll preach. Y'all didn't even hear that. That was good. You can fight the rhythm, but it's creating a dissonance that you won't enjoy. Now, perhaps you're hearing me and thinking either I don't have time to stop. There's too much on my plate, too much to be done, and too much that I've got to do. Or I'm good. Things are fine. I've got this under control, and I don't really think it takes all that. Let me ask you this. Do you find yourself more tired than you ought to be? Are you finding yourself more irritated lately? In the moments where you are quiet and alone, how are you feeling about yourself? Do you feel like you are stuck and you just can't get out of this rut, this season, this particular segment of your life? How do you feel about your connection with God? Do you feel close? How's your emotional well-being? Are your passions still marked by passion? Better yet, as John Wesley asked it, how is it with your soul? Let me suggest to you, not only should you make time to stop, you can't afford not to. It's time. It's time to make the pivot from activity to rest, and it begins by simply stopping. Just stop. Stop moving, stop trying, stop doing. Just stop. If you want to live, and I mean truly, vibrantly, abundantly live, you need to stop. You were made to stop. The rhythm of your life at a frenetic place filled with running and motion, your life is not making music and it's all off beat. You've got to stop. So, let me see if I can help you stop. Let me offer you this practice that I'd like you to try this week. Now, you don't need to do this every day, but pick a day to do the following. I want you to grab a group of your family or friends and find a day this week. Set aside 3 to 4 hour period of time to turn off your phone and to be fully present with each other and with God. Here's the key. Don't use the 3 hours to go to the movies. Share time with each other. Share your lives with one another. I would suggest you use the time to eat together, pray together, recall how God has been active in your lives with each other for in that week. Sing some songs, even if you do clap off beat. It's important that we understand that this is an act of community. Rather than simply time off or recreation or what we describe as, quote, self-care, remember, the Christian life is inherently life in community. And so I invite you, if you need to, we'll leave this on the screen for a little bit more, take a picture of the graphic, and I invite you to this practice. I encourage you to give yourself the space to live into this commandment. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. The move toward a good life begins with a pivot, and a pivot begins with a stop. With all the pace and demands on your life, let me invite you to simply stop in the name of love. Stop. Stop in the name of the one that loves you and calls you to love as you have been loved. Allow yourself the opportunity to operate with and in the rhythm of creation. Now, let me confess something to you. I have not done this well. So you're not alone. I'm not criticizing you. We're in this together. I have done this poorly. I have, in the name of trying to get things done, in the name of trying to do work for the kingdom, allowed myself to work myself silly. And then me, Jocelyn, the kids, we all look at each other like, what is wrong with the world? Like everything is falling apart because we just needed to stop. I don't think anybody was looking forward to this Christmas break more than the Hobdy family. Because we just needed to stop, and we didn't know how to get off the train. It felt like it was too far in motion and going too fast. But we needed to stop. So I'm confessing to you, I understand how difficult it is. But it's maybe the most necessary thing. There's a joke that this is the one commandment that we brag about not obeying. That's strange. Nobody brags about lying or being a murderer. That was a joke. All right. But we almost want awards for how much we will work. We just need to stop. And so tonight, as a primary act, a first act for the year, as a community, as a family, we're going to model what should be modeled in our homes, with our families, with our friends, with the people that are close to us, and we will have a kind of Sabbath moment where we stop and we remember that there was one who freed us from the things that would hold us down and back and hold us up in a way. On the night where he was betrayed, Christ stopped with his disciples. And he took bread, he blessed it, broke it, and said, "This is my body broken for you." And in the same manner, he took a cup filled with wine and said, "This is my blood shed for you." And he told them to stop. "As often as you do this in remembrance of me." And so we stop. All the things going on around us, everything that we came to this service with, we stop for a moment to simply recognize the goodness of God, to recognize his love for us, and to partake in this sacrifice in this way, so that by bringing his body into us, recognizing his body and his blood was given for us, we now go out to the world and offer ourselves and to give the healing and help and hope and love that the world so desperately needs. So I invite you now, as you think, as you prepare, as we get ready to partake in this wonderful gift, to join me in a moment of prayer as we pause together. Let's pray. God of grace and love and mercy, we thank you for who you are, for what you've done. You who are Lord of the Sabbath, Lord of rest, Lord who calls us to rest. We hear your call tonight. We hear you saying to us, stop, so that we might find rest and delight in our worship of you. So God, I pray in this moment that you would pour out your spirit on these elements of bread and cup, that they may be body and blood for us. And that you would help us to live and love the way that you did. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.